We here at Live from the Armory Wrestling Show pause to remember Jim the Anvil Neidhart.
Hey everybody, this is Bunkhouse Bob.
And the lovely Mary.
Live from the Armory Wrestling Show is heard worldwide. Wednesday night, 7 o'clock Eastern Time on Blog Talk Radio. But this is an FNX.network plug, which means we're heard from Mobile, Alabama to Melbourne, Australia. Wednesday night, 7 o'clock Eastern Time. Check us out on FNX.network. What do you say, Laura?
Lovely Laura, asking you, when you think of wrestling snacks, what comes to mind? Hot dogs? Popcorn? What about you, Bob?
Oh, some escargot, oysters Rockefeller, maybe a nice quiche.
You look like a quiche.
Seriously, folks, if you're looking for an awesome treat or a wrestling-inspired gift endorsed by both wrestlers and wrestling fans alike, look no further than Turnbuckle Cupcakes.
You can find Brandy and Julianne on their Turnbuckle Cupcakes Facebook page or visit them at www.turnbucklecupcakes.storeenvy.com.
Welcome to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, the premier podcast of indie wrestling.
I got into wrestling so I wouldn't have to faint. Hey, if I wanted to faint, I'd go get a real job.
Our studio line is area code 213-816-1605. With your host, Bunkhouse Bob.
It's not that I start things, Laura. I just remind people of certain things and then they catch on to your facade. They know that you're not the sweet person that you claim to be most of the time. They know deep down that you're mean. You are mean. You are
mean.
Like, you're like the quintessential, you're like, I don't know, like the founding mother of the Mean Girls movement. That's what you are.
And the lovely Laura.
You are full of monkey shit, is what you are. You are full of monkey shit.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. You're listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show. My name is the Bunkhouse Bob. Folks, this is episode 227 of the program, and we've got a real treat for you tonight. Coming up here in the 7:30 hour, we will have our interview with Jazzy Gabert, and we are always 100% transparent on this podcast. I want to let everybody know right up front, if you're trying to call in to ask a question or give a comment or anything like that, the interview with Jazzy is pre-recorded. Ta-da! The curtain has been pulled back, so to speak. We recorded the interview this past weekend with her, so obviously we will not be taking any live Q&A calls, but we certainly appreciate your support one way or the other. It doesn't matter to us. We thank you for listening to this program. Again, it's our 227th weekly episode of Live from the Armory Wrestling Show. If this is your first time listening, welcome. If this is your 227th time listening, welcome. And thank you very much for joining us tonight. We would encourage you to go over and check out our friends at Ignite Advocacy. You can find them at www.igniteadvocacy.org. You can also find them on Facebook. If you search Facebook for their Ignite Advocacy page, they are a group ran by Kim Artlip, the promoter, owner of Ignite Wrestling out of Florida, that links people up with different social services in the state of Florida, a great cause. Make sure you check them out. While you're doing that and you're on the Twitter machine tonight, go over and check out Indie Customs. You can find them at Indie_Customs. We are part of the Indie Customs family. Go over and give them some love. We would appreciate it. If you like what you hear on this broadcast and you'd like to support the show, there's a really easy way to do it. Go to www.prowrestlingtees.com, When you get there, enter FNX into the search bar. There are two shirts that you can choose from. Buy a shirt, help support the show. And if you have a question for myself, Laura, or George, you can always email us, whether it concerns a guest or anything like that concerning the show. You can hit us up at asktheArmory@gmail.com. And the most important thing for you to know tonight is this, folks. I have been told, this is an exclusive, that the Ricky Roberts hit single, These Boots Are Made for Walking, will drop on iTunes next week. I just had to get that in. Hi, John. Hope you're well. And joining me right now is the co-host of the program, the lovely Laura. How are you, Laura?
I'm pretty good, Bob. How about you?
I am dying over those freaking boots. I want them boots. I want those boots.
I tell you what, Raw was live from the Armory Monday night.
It was. There were several people that were on this past week's Monday Night Raw, emanating from Greensboro. Many of you will recognize John Schuyler, who was Ricky Roberts on the segment featuring Elias and Bobby Lashley, and those boots. I can't get over those boots. And he actually posted some, so I can say this. I messaged John that night and told him, you know, it was great seeing him on TV. And I told him I loved the boots, and he told me they let me keep the boots. So
that's awesome.
He has a picture of it up on his social media. The boots are laying there on the floor. They let him keep the boots. I love it.
You can't go wrong with that.
You can't go wrong with that. You want to go on and give out our social media stuff, and we'll go on and get
Certainly.
This episode rolling.
George, one bandana Coles, one air freshener can Coles, which we'll talk about that here in a little bit, is manning the Twitter machine tonight. He is at From the Armory right now. You can follow along with my life at Circle Sky, Bob's life at Bob_Delf, George's life, he's George One Life Coles. One life to Coles. There we go.
One life to live Coles.
That's right. One life to live Coles. At Heel Heat, and our good friend Dr. Goose is at The Gray Lobster.
Yeah.
You can find us on Facebook. You can just search Live from the Armory. You'll find two pages. One's our official page. The other is a fan page. You can also find us on YouTube, where every show for the past 2 years is uploaded onto there. So if you're out making towns, and maybe you don't have iTunes installed, or maybe you don't have Stitcher Radio, or maybe you can't get on Blog Talk, or maybe the FNX network is down, you can look at us on YouTube and listen to us, too. So you're making towns, listen to Live from the Armory. I bet someone you know, or even yourself, may have been on a show of ours.
That is true. That is true. Lots of guests. Lots of guests. How was your week this week? What happened?
Well, went to a car show on Saturday. Got Best mm-hmm. Ford, which we were very
cool.
happy with,
yeah.
Which is a pretty good thing because there's all kinds of Fords other than Mustangs, as car people know. And went to wrestling on Saturday night, AIWF Mid-Atlantic in Ivanhoe, Virginia. Got to talk with Michael Spencer, up-and-coming star. I see him a lot at AML. Also talked with another gentleman whose name just went right out of my head.
Yeah.
He's actually someone that's been on Raw as well. He showed me the picture of him and Adam Pearce. Hopefully these two gentlemen will be future guests. It was a lot of fun. Sexy Kavina, who is always one of my favorites, is actually one half of the tag champs, one half of the Mid-Atlantic, AIWF Mid-Atlantic tag champs.
Mm-hmm.
The referee had bibbed overalls on. It was very nice. One of the commentators
yes.
kept calling him the mayor of Ivanhoe, which he could have been. I don't know.
Maybe he was the mayor. Yeah. Mayor,
maybe,
part-time.
Maybe,
Yeah, mayor, part-time wrestling official, chief of the police.
Although I'm pretty sure that there is no mayor in Ivanhoe, but if there was one, I would vote for him.
Okay.
But lots of fun. My aunt enjoyed herself. AIWF coming to Mount Airy, and they got a great big card coming up this upcoming Saturday night, Deal with the Steel in Mount Airy, North Carolina. You can find out more information about that at AIWF Mid-Atlantic's Facebook page. Sandman's going to be there. Shane Douglas. All the matches are cage matches, so it's going to be a great thing. If you're in the Mount Airy, North Carolina area, you need to check that out. There's lots of stuff. We saw lots of people, as we were talking about, on Raw, SmackDown, and 205 Live, which I just want to say is I'm so proud of Tracer X, because I saw him at a Grindhouse show about 3 or 4 years ago, and now he's on 205 Live. So we're really super proud of you, Tracer X. He is one of the nicest people you'll ever want to meet, in or out of wrestling, just super nice and super humble and works really hard, you know.
Sure.
But real proud of you, Tracer. Yeah. And, lots of other stuff I know we're going to talk about here in a little bit. But I just wanted to say, again, I feel like we don't thank people enough for listening to the show and all the Twitter traffic we've had this week for our guests. Yes. So we want to thank everybody for that. We're here because of you guys, because you guys have decided that, you know, Bob and I are entertaining, which Bob and I have already known we're entertaining. We entertain ourselves.
I've known him since a young age, yes. Absolutely.
Yeah, so, you know, talking about your BFFs on Raw, good to see
absolutely.
The Dawson boys on Raw.
Hi,
good
Zane.
To see Dick James.
Yes, good to see him, too. Lots of people.
Well, I didn't get to see No Way Jose's conga line, so I don't even know. I'm sure there were people in there, too, that I didn't even get to
not
see.
Sure. I did not see
but
that.
But anyway, I think this, I'll say this and I'll shut up about that. I think that this is a example of how wrestling fans should be engaged in the show. That was a hot crowd, you know, Monday night.
Mm-hmm.
And I think a lot of it had to do with the fact that Greensboro is a wrestling town.
I would agree with that.
It's a wrestling town. Now, when WWE comes to Charlotte, it's not as the result is not the same. And I don't know why that reason is. I have no idea. And talking about AEWE, you know, Atlanta Wrestling Entertainment, you know, about how, you know, Atlanta's just kind of dead for wrestling, but it's funny because, you know, both cities, Atlanta and Greensboro, held Starcade. But Greensboro has somehow still held up, you know, as a great wrestling town. You know, Roanoke's the same way. You know, Raw always sells out. WWE always sells out when it comes to Roanoke.
Yeah.
So it's just an interesting – they were in Roanoke the night, you know, Sunday before Raw.
Mm-hmm.
The Raw roster was. But – I just think that's
an interesting geography. You know, I mean, you know, we're familiar with that area, and it's odd to me how between Greensboro and Charlotte the difference is in the crowd. Yeah, it just it always surprises me. But it's you know, but it's been that way from town to town. You know, just different. I don't want to say different. Obviously, not a different fan base. Just different geography, different viewpoint of wrestling, different viewpoint of the product, the way it's presented and consumed.
I tell you what, PWX, one of the hottest crowds they ever had was in Hickory.
Mm-hmm.
And at that armory. Hotter than hell. And I'm not talking about, like, temperature hot, because it's hot. But, you know, and they had to bring in chairs one time. Because they just sold so many. And it's just real funny. Hickory... any show I've ever been at in Hickory, no matter who it's for, hot town. You
hot
know,
town.
it's the darndest thing. But, you know, like I said, I just wanted to mention that, and also wanted to mention that the Revival, it was kind of Carolina heavy Monday night. You had the Revival there. You had Braun Strowman. You had your good friend, Matt Hardy, which that picture of him and King Maxwell was just so sad.
Very cool picture. We'll send out best wishes to Matt, too. Speaking of hot crowds, hot towns, you want to hit the Twitter poll?
Oh, yeah. Hold on. I got to get this up, y'all.
Just got to pull that up. Got to wind up the rubber band in the laptop. Got to get the mice turning the wheel.
Well, you know, this right here is actually, you know, I actually found my tablet, believe it or not.
Imagine that.
So here we go. We have got, what is the biggest selling point for the G1 Supercard?
Mm-hmm.
We had four choices, and one won overwhelmingly. So we have Ring of Honor, New Japan Pro Wrestling, WrestleMania weekend, Madison Square Garden. And I'm going to disagree with the poll, but we'll talk about that in a second. So Ring of Honor got 4% of the vote.
Okay.
New Japan Pro, WrestleMania weekend got 13, and Madison Square Garden got 61% of this vote.
Okay.
I disagree. I think what the draw is WrestleMania weekend. I really and truly do.
You know what, and I'm going to agree with you on that. Having been to four WrestleManias now, and the last three being the most notable, I mean, there's just so much going on. And I get the appeal, I get the draw that it is Madison Square Gardens, but what if potential liability of a lawsuit from Sinclair Media had been pulled back and said, you know what, we're not gonna do MSG. We'll find a different arena to run it. And it would have, you know, sold out there anyway. I mean, you know, to me, I think that there are just so many people that have came in. The thing that I noticed this past year when we went was the scheduling, how the schedule of events, because it used to be in years past when WrestleMania weekend came to town, there wasn't NXT, there was the Hall of Fame, but not everybody wanted to go to the Hall of Fame because it's an incredibly long night. I mean, there are so many things that are going on that the schedule has been pushed forward. I think this past year, I believe that the event started on, I want to say it was either Wednesday night or Thursday night. And there were shows running all day and all night long. Some shows going till 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock in the morning, because they knew that fans would be attending, you know, the access. They knew that they were going to be going to NXT TakeOver. They were going to be going to the Hall of Fame. You know, WrestleMania has just gotten so big now that they have to pick their spot. So I'm inclined to believe, go with you. I think it's because it's WrestleMania weekend. I'm not so much sold on the fact that it's Madison Square Gardens. I'm sure that had something to do with it, but I just don't know how much of the something that it was.
I really think, too, it might also, too, be kind of almost like a thumb to the nose of WWE.
Could be.
For fans, you know?
Could be.
I think that might have a lot to do with it, you know?
Well, the other thing that I know that the card hasn't even been addressed yet, and then we're going to, speaking of cards, we want to get this card on the phone here in just a second. I think that part of the appeal is that California has been spoiled, the West Coast has been spoiled with New Japan. This will be the first time on the East Coast that pure fans, I mean, these people that come to WrestleMania weekend, I want to make sure that I word this correctly, I think are not only casual fans, but they're more than casual fans, because WrestleMania weekend is an investment. You have people from all over the world that come into this. And this will be their maybe once-in-a-lifetime opportunity, obviously, not only to attend WrestleMania, but to see someone from New Japan Pro Wrestling or Ring of Honor that, you know, they likely may not get the opportunity to ever see again. So there is that draw. There is that appeal. Does the actual physical building play a whole lot into it? I'm not so much sold on it. I am sold on the fact that when you have people traveling from Australia and Japan and the UK and Germany and Mexico and Canada coming to that one event or coming to that one area to see people that they've wanted to see their whole lives, that plays a bigger part into it than anything else, in my opinion. I want to get this world traveler on the phone, a special friend of the show. Chris Dickinson traveled this past week, actually did a pretty big loop and went to the Mae Young Classic tapings this past weekend, and also went to a Progress show. I want to welcome Chris to the show. Hi, Chris. How are you?
All right, guys. How you doing?
Doing really well. Doing really well.
Hey, Chris.
Hey, Laura. How are you?
I'm doing well. You look at you. You jet setting, limousine riding.
More like Honda CRV driving.
Honda CRV.
It was about 47 hours and 2,800 miles.
Holy
wow.
moly.
6 days. Yeah, it was nuts. Yeah. But it was worth it.
Long time listeners of this show will remember that you came on the show last year and gave us a report on the Mae Young Classic, and you rolled the dice and went again this year. So did it live up to the hype, the second installment of the Mae Young Classic?
No, it exceeded the hype. I mean,
oh, wow.
Nothing that I can say about this would be hyperbole. I mean, I'm going to throw a lot of adjectives out there, and when you see the show, they'll be justified.
Okay.
So,
well, the floor is yours, sir.
Okay, so first just some big picture stuff. So if there was kind of an unspoken theme to the show, of how the show felt, I think the best word would be intensity. It was a lot more intense than last year. I mean, last year the matches were great, but this year it almost seemed like all the women were stepping up and saying, we're going to show everyone just how technical, athletic, tough, and hard-hitting women's wrestling can be. I mean,
oh, wow.
Some of the matches will really blow you away. You know, put it this way, one of these semifinal matches should definitely be a candidate for match of the year. It was just,
oh wow,
just that good. And
okay.
They were, put it simply, they were beating the hell out of each other.
Right.
Dang.
And so, okay. Like last year, really good matchmaking, great storytelling. So, within the matches, these are just first round. For example, Rachel Ellering came back as Rachel Evers. She faced off against Hiroyo Matsumoto, and you guys know how physical Rachel can be. And
right.
Hiroyo matched up with her in terms of physicality, skill. They just absolute war. Xia Li took on Karen Q, and they framed it as a martial arts matchup, so it was a really good match in that way. Tony Storm and Ginny both wrestle in Progress, and they're both feuding in Progress, so they wrestle in the first round to kind of play off their feud in Progress. You had Xia Brookside, kind of the young upstart, taking on Io Shirai, the established superstar, if you will. So a lot of really good matchmaking, and the tournament just built and built. So by the time you get to the quarterfinals and semifinals, you're going to be on the edge of your seats.
Cool.
And just a lot of moments.
I can't wait.
Take your breath away. Let's see. And I'd call it some of the best wrestling I've ever seen, period. It's just, they deserve all the praise and all the accolades they get. And it was really cool that Mia Yim got the please sign chant this year that Jazzy got last year. She deserved that, and I hope they actually do that. In terms of just competitors, just a few names, So last year they had several women who had just started the Performance Center. A few of them came back. So Kavita Debbie, Reina Gonzalez, Tenara Conti. And they were all vastly improved from last year.
Okay.
So they really looked like they belonged in the ring. Recent signees, Jesse Eleban and Casey Catanzaro. I don't think either came from a wrestling background. Casey came from American Ninja.
Right.
Both looked excellent. You'll be impressed by both of them.
Okay.
Let's see. From the Indies, Mercedes Martinez, Mia Yim, Rachel Ellering, Rhea Ripley with a new look, new attitude, and Toni Storm all came back. They all stood out. And just a brief word about Toni. She has, I said it last year, implies even more this year, she has giant superstar written all over her.
Yeah.
She's just, between athleticism, technical ability, presence, and I got a chance to meet her after the Progress show, and she is incredibly down to earth, really great to talk to, so. And then you remember Caitlin, former Divas champion. She came back.
Yeah.
New look, new moveset. She is a fundamentally different wrestler, and she, you'll be really surprised with her.
Okay.
That's awesome. She was always one of my favorites.
Yeah.
Yeah. She's, you're going to be impressed. So, and like I said,
okay,
just some of the best wrestling you're going to see.
Now, a lot of listeners, I'm going to interject something here. A lot of listeners will be saying, but Chris isn't giving us who won the matches. He's not telling us who's in the quarters, who's in the semis. And that's because on this particular program, we have a firm belief of we hate spoilers. And Chris knows this, and Chris has always did this last year. We don't put out spoilers. The spoilers are all over the internet. If you want to read them, that's great. I personally have been trying to keep one eye open and one eye closed because I want to watch the classic. I want to watch the classic
right
on the network. I don't want to read about the spoilers that are permeating the internet. So Chris has been very great about pointing out people both in last year's tournament and this year's tournament to keep an eye on. Out of the 32 competitors, I am going to ask you this, Chris. Out of the 32 competitors that were there this year, who impressed you the most?
That's tough. Mako Satomura was in the tournament, and she's an absolute legend in wrestling. She
mm-hmm.
was outstanding. It was my first time seeing her. She was really impressive. But I'm going to say, out of all of them, the one who impressed me most, Toni Storm.
Okay.
Like I said, WWE
okay.
was wise to sign her to that UK contract. She'll be, they'll be good to, wise to build that UK brand around her, and I'm sure
around
we'll
her.
See her on the main
yeah.
roster at some point.
I would believe that.
I would say easily more than half of those women have star potential. I also want
okay.
to mention Ariel Monroe.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
On the Mae Young Classic. She looked excellent. Seems like she's really hitting her stride in the ring. It was just great to see her there.
Yeah.
Great to be able to see her there and see Cedric cheering her on and the little one cheering her on and meet
yes, little AJ.
Okay. So
awesome.
That's the Mae Young Classic, and I posted some pictures
yeah.
on Twitter. I didn't post any spoiler pictures just from the first round.
Mm-hmm.
My spoiler pictures are on Facebook if anyone wants to see those.
Okay.
And then just quickly, Progress. So they've been touring the country in a giant bus, so I'm sure they're all worn out. I'll say this about Progress Wrestling. Very fun show. All the wrestlers very athletic, very fan-friendly. The crowd is absolutely electric. It's like
yes.
the crowd walks in and they say, this is Progress, we know we're going to have a blast. And they just go home. Like you said, Laura, it's what a wrestling crowd should be.
Right.
You know, mature audiences in this case, but absolutely hot crowd all night long, into everything, supporting all the wrestlers. Jim Smallman, who's one of the owners, he's also the ring announcers, super nice guy, hung around to talk to the fans. I could chat with him for a few minutes. And just one thing to remember, if you go to a Progress show, there is one rule. Don't be a dick. you know, at the beginning of the show. It's,
yeah.
You know, for all the silliness, everyone's really respectful of the wrestlers and each other, and it's just great, great fun.
Yeah.
Just a couple things to point out. So there was a four-way match between Brody King, Matt Riddle, Trent Seven, Elliot Sexton, and I think it has to be described as strong style comedy because it was a it had comedy integrated into a strong style match in a very intelligent way, and they just told a really, really fun story throughout. Also, Jimmy Havoc, he opened the show. He faced Mark Andrews. So there are a number of wrestlers who you've seen on NXT who are in the NXT UK brand. And Jimmy Havoc is another superstar talent. He just has all these intangibles that make him just so engaging to watch.
Yeah.
So good. And then also there was an intergender match, six-person match. And Toni Storm and Ginny were the two women on their respective sides. And some people say stupid things about intergender matches, and none of that applied to here. They totally held their own. Toni Storm was throwing around the guys like small sacks of potatoes, and she was taking everything they threw at them. I mean, and so I would say if you get a chance to go to a progress show, even if you have to drive several hours, go. And spend some time talking to the wrestlers while you're there. It's just, I'm assuming there's going to be a Mae Young Classic next year. I'll go to that, and if progress is the next day, I'll drive there. I don't care where it is.
Oh, wow.
It's obvious that progress has convinced you, so that's pretty cool. I had got the opportunity when WrestleMania weekend was in Dallas. There were several people from the progress roster on there, and I can agree with you with the fans, the progress fans that were in attendance were super energetic and super fun. And I would highly recommend it as well, that if you have the opportunity to catch a progress wrestling show, you should do that. It spins a whole new light on a lot of things. So that's cool. I'm glad you got the opportunity to go.
Yeah, so am I. I knew I'd have a hellish semester this semester, so I figured I'd get my wrestling fix while I could.
Yeah, no kidding. You got to get that before all the kids come back.
That's right.
Oh, they're already taking over the town of Boone now.
There you go.
It does.
Yep. Appalachian State is already hopping.
There we go. Chris, thank you so much for coming on the show tonight and giving us your Mae Young Classic report and progress report. We appreciate it, brother, and look forward to seeing you soon in November.
Yeah. Yeah, thanks for having me, guys. Look forward to seeing you at WrestleCade.
All right.
See you at WrestleCade.
All right. Have a good night, guys.
All right. Have a good
night.
There goes good friend Chris Dickinson. He mentioned that he was a professor. He's a doctor of thugonomics, is what Chris is. Doctor of thugonomics. We're going to go on. I know that everybody's dying to hear this, and I think that you're going to get a lot out of this. I had the opportunity to sit down and talk with Jazzy Gabert this past weekend, and I really, really think that everybody is going to enjoy this. I know that I had a great time talking to her. So without any more from me, we're going to play our Jazzy Gabert interview. Well, ladies and gentlemen, any time that we get to do an interview on Live from the Armory Wrestling Show through FNX Network is great. But today, it's like freaking awesome. And I'm going to tell you why it's awesome, because today we get to sit down with an international wrestling superstar. I could spend the next 5 or 10 minutes running down a ton of accolades and I could waste all of our time, but I'm not going to do that. Instead, I'm just going to tell you, courtesy of FNX Network and Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, we would like to welcome Jazzy Gabert to the program. Jazzy, how are you today?
Hi, thank you so much. Thank you so much for the introduction. I hope I'm not wasting your time, too. I think we're going to have a lot of good questions.
Oh, I think we're going to have a lot of fun. We're going to have a lot of fun. And no, you're not wasting our time. I would be remiss if I didn't tell folks, we want to thank Jazzy for being with us tonight. We coordinated this. We're halfway around the world, and really, really appreciate, humbled and honored that you would take time out of your day to be with us. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me.
You're welcome. First and foremost, I mean, how are you feeling physically? I read on your Twitter from this week, you said, quote, "I'm in happy tears. The doctor once told me it's over, but he was wrong." Give us the update. We're all wanting to hear that you're back and stronger than ever.
Yes, I'm back. Like, I had my surgery on January 15, and before that, like, I went to a couple of doctors, and one of the doctors, he told me, "It's over. You will never wrestle again." And I was like, I was not, like, in shock. I was more like, what the hell is this doctor doing? Like, he cannot say to a professional athlete that you never, ever can do any kind of sports, you know? And I was a little bit angry, too. Like, he can say it to a housewife. She would be super happy not doing sports, you know? But you can't
right.
say this kind of stuff to a professional, yeah.
No.
So I went to another doctor, and he said, let's see what we can do, you know? And first, he didn't want to do the surgery because, you know, it was a little bit complicated, and long story short, I got him to do the surgery, and now 6 months later, I'm fully healed. Like, I'm fully, like, there was nothing. I mean, I have, of course, like, a little piece in my neck now, but it will not hold me back to do wrestling again. And my doctor say, of course, he does not recommend wrestling, but he said
right.
there's nothing against it, you know. But
how does it
no matter what, yeah.
No, go ahead. I'm sorry. I shouldn't have jumped in. Go ahead.
I just want to say no doctor, like, ever wants to do, like, say that we have to do wrestling. Like, there's no doctor in the world who would agree to do it. So, yeah.
How does one deal with that mentally, Jazzy? I mean, you alluded to it. You're telling a professional athlete, I mean, this is what you do. This is what you've done.
Mm-hmm.
How do you deal with that mentally?
I mean, you know, the whole story with WWE and everything, it was just the worst timing ever. Like, oh, my God, I have to say, I was really, really down. I was really sad. And it was, like, how I always heard about. Like, you know, I went to WWE, Mae Young Classic. I did, like, a great job, and they signed me. And then all of a sudden, I had so many friends. I had sponsor asking me, you know, if I want to work with them. And I was, you know, I wouldn't say on top of the game, but it was much better than before. And then a few weeks later, there was a big report that I got hurt and that the contract was, I don't know English word. and then nobody was calling me anymore. Like, all my new friends are gone. Like, all the sponsors are gone. Like, I'm standing there with no money, with no friends, basically. And I'm like, what the hell is happening here? Yeah, it was so strange. Like, of course, I have, like, my super duper fans who are always there with me, my friends who don't care if I'm successful or not. But, like, these people who didn't call me, like, 2-3 years, all of a sudden they were there, and then boom, they were gone again. I'm like,
wow,
this is absolutely crazy. And then the whole thing, do I have to stop? Like, I'm a wrestler, this is all I'm doing. I look like a wrestler, I am a wrestler, so you cannot tell me I can't do this anymore. And it was just crazy. And I live in a house full of fighters. Like, I moved to a town where there's a lot of MMA going on, and because I started doing MMA, so I made the decision I want to be around fighters and I want to just live this kind of lifestyle. And now I'm the one who's injured, and everyone is going to training, everyone is having fun and talking about fighting, and I'm here, and the doctors told me, you're not a fighter anymore, you can't do this. It was tough, it was so tough, you have no idea. And I question if I did the wrong decisions. I mean, the way I look right now, with, you know, with all the muscles, I did it for wrestling. Like, if it was for me personally, to be honest, I would look totally different. I would look like a skinny little girl. Because I wanted to look like that. I wanted to look like a machine for wrestling, you know, with the hair, with the blonde short hair. I did it all because I love this business so much, and I wanted to be, you know, successful. And then all of a sudden someone told me it's all end, you know, my dream WWE, I had it in my hand, but then it was gone. It was it was a nightmare. And I mean, it still is. I mean, the last 6 months, I hope you, or I bet you reckon there were so much things going on, World of Sports in England, and then NXT UK, then the Mae Young Classic, then the Evolution, and so many stuff. Like even TNA has now a lot of female wrestling going on, and Stardom is also like in Japan, it's like really big right now. And I'm seeing all these people, all these girls living my dream, you know. And I got sometimes requests, like some people somehow didn't notice that I got injured. So they're sending me, hey, do you want to work here? Do you want to work here? And I'm like, I want, but I can't. And it was really heartbreaking.
I want to jump into two things that you brought up in that subject. You'd mentioned TNA and you mentioned WWE. You talk about the Mae Young Classic. When you were involved with the Classic last year, did you have any signs or symptoms of this neck injury, or did this just come completely out of the blue, out of left field?
No, to be honest, I always had, since a long time, since I was in Japan, I had a lot of neck pain. But for me, it was always normal because I'm a wrestler and, you know, I wrestle every weekend and I have like a lot of shows and then training a lot, like sometimes three times a day, you know, and I do sparring, and then when you get punched or joked out, you know, it's of course not easy for the body. So I kind of thought, okay, this is my life. I have to live with this kind of pain. And when I heard that I'm going to the Mae Young Classics, I was training extra hard. I mean, I always train hard, but then I wanted to train extra hard. I did a lot of neck bridges and this kind of stuff. And then something felt weird, and I was telling to my friends, I think I need a massage, you know, I have this little pain over there. And people saw me all the time, you know, having problems with my shoulder, and I'm like, yeah, it's just a pinched nerve. It's nothing bad, just a pinched nerve. So, yeah, I had pain. I had a lot of pain, but I never, ever thought it would be that serious, you know.
Right. You had mentioned TNA, and once upon a time, you did work for a company called TNA, and a lot has changed with that organization. And when I say a lot, I mean everything. I mean, it's now Impact Wrestling, featuring stars such as Tessa Blanchard, Sue Young, Ali, so on and so forth. Do you feel that Impact Wrestling is taking advantage of the NXT system by offering talents immediate television exposure versus an uncertain amount of time at NXT developmental?
To be honest, I'm not really into Impact right now or to the stuff what's going on with Impact, because there was a lot of things, you know, like a lot of changes, as you say. I heard about Sue Young, that she's doing like a great job there, and I see here and there on Twitter and social media, but I'm not really involved. I know that Tessa Blanchard is there now, and the stuff I'm seeing, it looks great, you know, and I guess if they would offer me something like a contract or something, I would definitely look more into it. But right now, there's so much stuff out there, like so many wrestling is going on, and my eyes are still on Japan because I love the style of wrestling. And I watch a lot of New Japan stuff, and I watch a lot of stuff what the Young Bucks and Cody Rhodes are doing, because I think they're trailblazers, you know. They're doing something different, and they are successful without WWE, and this is really super impressive for me. And, of course, I'm a female wrestler, and I should look what other females are doing, but I'm a little bit aiming higher, and I want to do as successful as the boys right now. But I don't know if I get there, but it's definitely I'm searching for role models higher than what I do already.
Well, the Young Bucks and Cody, they certainly are a lofty role model to shoot after. I mean, the All-In event is coming up in September, a sold-out Sears Center in Chicago. Speaking of that, in historic fashion, it was announced this week that the Ring of Honor New Japan Pro Wrestling Show, scheduled for WrestleMania weekend, has sold out Madison Square Garden. It'll be the first time a non-McMahon-owned company has done so in 60-plus years. What does this tell you about the state of independent professional wrestling?
Crazy. It's so crazy. And it also shows how much power the fans actually have. And I say that, like, you can hear my interviews, like, from years ago. I always say the fans have so much power. And, of course, there's the WWE, and they have a lot of, like, much more reach to the people. But, man, I don't know. If we work hard, if we believe in a dream and everything and really work hard, we can make a difference. WWE is not the only thing anymore. You know, there's different things. I'm not sure if ever something equal will come up, but, you know, there's alternatives. Like, if you don't like the WWE product, you can watch Ring of Honor, you can watch New Japan Wrestling, you know. And if you're a female wrestling fan, there's so many female promotions out there, like Shine and Shimmer and Pro Wrestling Eve in the UK. And there's so much stuff out there. And with the internet, with social media these days, there's so much more opportunity. Like, when I started back in the days, that the internet was just on their way up. You know, we had MySpace back in the days. I think
right.
People don't even know what
right.
that is anymore. You know? So,
yeah, I know.
Yeah. Being a wrestling fan these days, it's the best thing that can happen. Like, it's amazing. So much stuff is going on.
Do you feel a certain sense of responsibility on social media in this internet age? I mean, we hear all the crazy stories about people being paid to go back through people's social media accounts and digging up tweets from 5, 6, 7 years ago. What's your approach or your viewpoint on social media and wrestling?
You know what, like social media in general, not just in wrestling, I think it's really dangerous. And sometimes I'm really concerned. Like, I have, like, my brother, for example, he has young kids and they're like 11, 13 in this kind of direction. And they're posting
mm-hmm.
really weird stuff. And I think they will be embarrassed
right.
when they look at it, like when they're older, or one day maybe they are applying for a job. And then, you know, the boss, he looks at the social media and sees these girls half naked or drunk or anything like that. And it's bad. It's just bad. Well, I don't know. Like, even if you make a joke, like, it happened to me too, you know, like we're using a lot of stuff like, hey, you train like a girl, you're pussy, this kind of stuff. But in these days,
mm-hmm.
everyone is offended so easily. So you cannot even put these kind of stuff out there because someone might think in a different way, you know, and that it can hurt you actually. Like, you have to be really careful, like not just with wrestling, like in general. I hear that a lot of people are getting bullied and then they do suicide because they can't take the bullying via social media, you know, or
mm-hmm.
like if you're like a star, if you're in the wrestling industry or whatever, and you get like a shitstorm, like, I don't know if you know what it is, but it's like when a lot of people like attacking you, it doesn't matter what it is. Like, maybe you're just wearing the wrong shirt or something. People are doing suicide over it. So we have to take this really serious and be careful what we put out there, you know? And
no,
I
agree.
See the whole stuff with the nude pictures, you know, like look at Paige,
right.
for example. Oh my God. Like, it's horrible what she had to go through, you know? Like,
right.
I mean, I don't know about the general person, like, but I have nude pictures on my phone, you know, like if someone would hack me or something, I would be so shocked and devastated. So I cannot even imagine how this girl feels. And it's not just in wrestling, it's also like in high school or somewhere, stuff like this happens all the time. And it's scary. Social media is scary.
It is very scary. Are fans too hypercritical of professional wrestling on social media? I mean, when did the crossover from being just a fan to being a vocal fan happen, do you think?
That's also like a really complicated thing. I mean, when I was
yeah.
a fan, I would never ever dream of criticizing a wrestler, you know, or telling him, oh, you shouldn't do this move, or your music is, you know, like, oh my God, like, I don't get it. And then also there's this different kind of styles, you know, like there's the old school style, and then there's like a strong style, and then there's the flippy style, and everybody has an opinion, and everyone is like just fighting over it instead of enjoying it. I mean, if I watch something I don't like, I mean, if it's backyard, of course, I'm really annoyed about it, and I wish it would not be there. But let's say about a wrestling style that not fits my idea of wrestling, I would never ever dare to go on the internet and say, hey, this is not good, this is crap. Like, you know what I mean? Like, just let it be, you know? Like, just enjoy the stuff you like. And I always say, promote the stuff you love instead of bashing the stuff you hate, you know, because it's not making it better. Like, if you write something, I don't like this, people will like, oh, what you don't like? Oh, let me see what you don't like. But why you don't put something on and, hey, I like this, I want more of this, you know what I mean? So yeah, it's the fans are a little bit crazy, but it's not just in wrestling, it's in general. Like, people think they can have an opinion just because someone is out there, you know, and they don't see it as entertainment anymore. They think they own the life of a superstar, if it's like in music or wrestling or whatever, you know. They think because it's on social media or because they are out there, they have the right to dictate something. And I think it's not right. They should let everybody live their life as they can.
We've had lengthy conversations and discussions on this program about this, the anonymity of the internet, the hidden keyboard warrior. And when I know and you know that that person would never walk up to that person face to face and say some of the things that they put out on Twitter or on Instagram or whatever flavor of the week app that we have on our phone. I think it's ludicrous to me. Some of the stuff that I read, it's like people have no, what's the right word I'm looking for? Couth in their life. They have no moral compass. They just wouldn't say that. I don't know.
Yeah, but you call them keyboard warriors. I think that's a way too nice word. I call them button trolls because they're no warriors at all.
The button troll. I like that. I'm going to have to borrow that in the future. I think that's awesome.
But you're right. These people would never walk up to you, you know. They would never say something like this in the face. But even if, like, look at my character, for example. I'm a lot of masculine, you know, and you know, I choose to be that way. Like, if people know me in private, they know I can be like a really feminine person, but in the ring I want to portray this stuff. And man, like, especially when the Mae Young Classic aired and there was a lot of different kind of fans, there were like a lot of mainstream fans, I read a lot of really horrible things, something like she's a transvestite, or since when are men allowed in a female tournament, you know, like something like this. But if this person would know the person behind it, like if they would meet in person, you know, or would give me some time to check me out and everything, they would never, ever say something like this. And people who writing so stupid things, I would say, they actually show me that they are not really intelligent, you know, that they're really limited. Because a smart person, a person with compassion, would never, ever say some rude or mean things, you know what I mean?
No, I do know what you mean. Do you think that that's what people are most surprised by, Jazzy, when they meet you outside of wrestling, that the Jazzy of the in-ring is not the Jazzy that is out of the ring, the character separation?
Yeah, absolutely. Like, you know, sometimes I struggle. Maybe I should only put alpha female out there, but then sometimes the real Jazzy comes up. Or like if I'm on the show and the people come up for autograph stuff, I don't want to, you know, be mean to them. So that's like the Jazzy that come out. Like, I'm actually the total opposite. I'm shy and I'm sweet and I don't want to hurt anybody. But alpha female, she don't give a damn. She just want to kick ass, you know.
Right.
That's the opposite. And especially him in this town where I'm living, when people only see me walking down the street or walking to the gym, they think I'm a killer and I'm beating them up right now. But then they start talking to me and like, wow, you're actually really nice. I thought different about you. I'm like, yeah, I know.
they're real timid. They kind of are, maybe I should, maybe I shouldn't. Maybe she'll clothesline me right here in the street. You know, that kind of thing.
I have it sometimes at the signings that they want to take a picture with me, but they're so afraid. And then I'm like, come on, I don't bite you. Come on. So it's not easy.
Right. That's awesome. If you could describe the independent wrestling scene in Germany using only one word, what would that word be and why?
I would say rising. It's on the rise. Mm. It's getting bigger and bigger. And we're not longer to be overlooked because we have a lot of awesome stuff. WXW, for example, going on. They're super professional. They have more than 50 shows in a year. And we have GWF, German Wrestling Federation. They're also having a lot of internet stuff going on. You can check them out. They have also like a network, you know, where you can watch the shows weekly. And they're entertaining. And we have a lot of good superstars. I mean, look at Alexander Wolfer or Muscle Bottle on WWE. You know, they're from Germany.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Killer Kelly, she moved from Portugal to Germany to learn everything. And now she was in WWE Mae Young Classic, you know. So we have quality, and we are on the rise. Yeah.
If you had to pick a winner for the Mae Young Classic this year, I mean, who would you pick? I mean, there, like you said, there's 32 competitors. There's a lot of great talent. Who would you pick? Who would you pick this year?
I mean, you know that they already aired. Not aired, but it was already on. So people, I don't want to spoiler it, but I think the finals are totally, I don't know, they were predictable. I knew who is going to be in the finals. From these two, without spoiling it,
I've tried not to look. I didn't want to know. Don't tell me. I've got to pick. I'm purposely keeping my eyes closed until it airs, I guess,
right,
if I can.
But yeah, from all the 32 people, I think it's Toni Storm. But I wish, to be honest, I wish it's Maiko Satomura, because she is freaking amazing. If you people don't know her yet, you really should check her out. Maiko Satomura, she's a Japanese legend. She was there when All Japan was still there, and she's a 20 years, and she's freaking amazing.
Awesome. Awesome. Jazzy, if my last question for you this evening is this. If it hadn't been for professional wrestling, where would you be? What would you be doing?
Oh, wow. That's a tough question. I think I wouldn't be alive, to be honest. I think I would not be alive, because wrestling saved my life in many ways, you know. I do have a dream what's after wrestling, and my wrestling, what I'm doing, my whole, you know, my whole brand I'm building, I have a goal with it. Maybe you a little bit know about my story, but I come from, you know, a foster house. I don't have parents. So my ultimate goal is to make it somehow with WWE, or just making it, you know, being like super on top. And then I want to go at the end of my career, I want to go after my career, I want to go to people who are less fortunate, like people from the foster homes, people like kids who have just a really bad start in life. I want to tell them, look at me, I made it, so you can make it too, because I personally think I don't have a lot of talent, but I have a lot of heart, and my heart brought me where I am today. You know, I'm 10 times world champion. I wrestle all around the world. I was in TV, and I did do WWE. So if I can make it, or if I can do it, you can do it too. And I'm talking to every single person out there who's listening to this right now. You can do it if you really want to, and if you really set your priorities and stop putting out excuses. You have to make a decision that you want to do it, whatever it is. If it's wrestling, if it's acting, if it's, I don't know, just building your own house or starting a family, you have to convince yourself that you're good enough and you will do it.
If you can believe it, you can achieve it. That's one of my favorites.
Yeah, like famous Conor McGregor says. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that you have a ton of talent. I think that you have a ton of heart. And I also think that a lot of times, even the smallest of people, children, the vertically challenged, have a small voice, but they still have a voice, and those voices need to be heard. And I certainly wish you all the best in that future endeavor of yours. I think that's a very, very admirable, thing that you would like to do. And I certainly wish you nothing but success with that, whenever you decide to do it. And I know you'll do great at it. That would be awesome.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
For fans, for European fans, for German fans that may be listening to this podcast this evening, what upcoming appearances do you have on the horizon that if fans want to come out and see you in action, where are you going to be at coming up?
Yeah, you have to go on September 1st to Oberhausen, to WXW. I will challenge Toni Storm for the Women's Championship, and I will give my best. I want to beat her, and I want to be the next WXW Women's Champion, September 1st in Oberhausen.
Very cool. And for fans that are interested in Jazzy Gabert merchandise, is there a pro wrestling tee store? How can they get a hold of merchandise?
Yes. You can go on the Pro Wrestling Tee store, and on September 6th, I will open up a new store where there will be like retro, like the very first alpha female t-shirt, and there will be like freaking awesome new designs. And on September 6th, I will put it online. You can find me on my social media, Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook, and then you can see all the information about it.
And what are those social media handles? How do people find you on Twitter?
It's Jazzy Gabert, Jazzy, like J-A-Z-Z-Y, and Gabert. But if you have struggles finding me, type in German female wrestler. You can find me because I'm the only one till now. And, yeah, I think if you put in really strong female wrestler, you will find me too.
See, those are more accolades, people. All you got to do is just Google German female wrestler,
yes,
and she pops up right like that. It's the power of the internet.
Absolutely.
An incredible thing.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Jazzy, again, thank you so much for being on the show tonight. Had an absolute pleasure talking to you, and certainly wish you nothing but the best in the future. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having me. Thank you. Bye.
Everybody, Bunkhouse Bob and Lovely Lori here. Folks, does the man make the title, or does the title make the man? Age-old question with a simple answer. That is, if you're wearing a title made by Top Rope Belts.
Established in 2006, and with a satisfied client list, including Lucha Underground, the LA Dodgers, New Japan Pro Wrestling, Ohio Valley Wrestling, the National Wrestling Alliance, and many, many more. Top Rope Belts uses 100% custom drawing and does all of their own etching. That means quality from start to finish, folks.
Folks, whether you're a private collector, a wrestling promotion, or a business who wants a quality championship title belt, look no further than Top Rope Belts. Check them out on Facebook or visit them at www.topropebelts.com. Had an incredible time having the opportunity to talk with Jazzy Gabert, and I really, really hope that you enjoyed the interview. I had a blast doing it. It didn't even feel like an interview. It just things just kind of rolled, and there were several interesting things in there that I hope that people picked up on that seemed to kind of tie into some breaking news or some things that transpired today on social media. But first and foremost, Laura, what did you think about Jazzy Gabert?
Oh, she is absolutely awesome. And, you know, I was really taken aback by her saying, you know, if it wasn't for wrestling, I'd be this little girl. You know,
yeah.
I wouldn't be this big hulked up, you know. And it is quite amazing. And we all know that wrestling is an aesthetic kind of business.
Right.
It just is. It, you know, good, bad, or indifferent. It is what it is. And one of the things we always talk about that makes wrestling believable is that you got to look a certain way, because why would you want to pay money to see somebody that looks like a guy off the street come in and fight? You know what I mean?
Right.
But the pressure, men and women have it, but I think maybe women have it a little more anyway, because we have that in our day-to-day lives without being a wrestler. But, yeah, I mean, just I don't think I've ever heard a female wrestler say that, you know.
Yeah.
If it were up to me, I'd just be this skinny little girl, you know.
Right, no, and that was one of the things that I took away. Obviously, some of the things that transpired today on the internet were Dave Meltzer making comments about Peyton Royce from the WWE. And when I went back through and I listened to this, you know, with Jazzy, what I took away from it was that this was a woman that knew what the alpha female character was going to be, or knew what it was going to take. And to her, it almost sounded to me that there was a sacrifice, there was a trade-off, that if I'm going to be
oh,
the
yeah.
alpha female,
that I'm going to have to be this bulked up super female athlete. And I traded that for being more feminine, that I wouldn't have done this,
right,
you know, if it not had been for the alpha female character. And then, you know, talking about, people looked at her or comment about her on social media saying, you know, well, what, you know, is this really a woman? You know, is she a transvestite? That, you know, that people, if they know me outside of the ring, I'm very feminine. I'm very girly girl. I like to dress up. I like to do different things. And I think that's something that, you know, that fans don't take into consideration, the amount of sacrifice that she was willing to put in to portray alpha female.
I'm going to say this, and pardon my French, who the fuck asked someone, are you male or female? Who does that?
Well,
you know, I mean.
It's kind of blown up all over today. It's been what we've been talking about, I don't know, for ad nauseum for a long time on this program. You know, and I really like what she, you know, she doesn't even use the term keyboard warrior. She uses the term
button troll.
And there's button trolling that goes on from the most casualist of fan all the way up to somebody that was allegedly respected in this business, today. It just goes to show.
Yeah, allegedly respected, I think, is a great term.
Yeah, I mean, his stock has incredibly dropped. You know, his whole star rating system, you can take that and put a roll of Charmin with it, because it's gone right down the toilet, in my opinion. I absolutely flabbergasted that Dave Meltzer would put something like that out on air, referring to Peyton Royce and how she was better when she was lighter in NXT. What a joke. What a joke.
Here's the thing that there's two things I want to talk about. First thing is I didn't know what Dave Meltzer looked like till about maybe 3 years ago.
Well, let's be nice. When you can't.
I'm just saying that I'm surprised that someone who is not maybe aesthetically pleasing says things like that.
That old
saying, people who live in glass houses shouldn't throw stones.
Throw stones, yes, ma'am. I'm familiar with that saying.
That's all I'm going to say about that.
Yes.
And here's another thing, too. That's why I live in a brick house. people who live in glass houses should dress in basements.
I get you.
Here's something that I'm gonna talk about, something I've personally had happen in my life over many, many times, is I've heard people say, oh, wow, you have such a pretty face. If only you could lose some weight. You're pretty for a big girl.
Right.
Really? Really, because, you know, beauty comes in all shapes and sizes. And
right.
If we all looked the same, life on this planet would be pretty boring.
Yeah.
I don't understand why a woman in 2018 has to put up with that bullshit. And I know people are saying, well, the guys go through that. No, I'm going to have to say, no. Guys do go through that, but they do not go through it at the extent that women do. Like I said,
right,
we go through that in our everyday lives.
Yeah.
It's not on the same level. I'm sorry. It's just not. And I just think that the moral of the story of this is that people need to think before they type. Think about, would you want someone to say that to you or about someone you love? And if the answer is no, then you might want to just keep that to yourself. There's an old adage that just because you can say something doesn't mean that you should.
And she talked about that, the power and the responsibility of social media. The other thing that she mentioned, that she being Jazzy in the interview, that I never really thought about until she said it, was, you know, the performance at the Mae Young Classic, the offering, you know, signing the WWE contract, because she did sign a WWE contract, going through medical and finding out about the discs. But in between the time of signing the contract and finding out about the injury, the number of people that I, what do you want to call them? Not people that grab on, clingers,
hangers on,
coattail
riders.
Yeah. You know, she mentioned it, you know, the sponsorships, the people that, you know, all of a sudden, you know, hooked their cars onto the train, so to speak, to be pulled along. And when the injury was found out and knew that she was going to be required surgery, the WWE rescinded the contract, said, hey, you know, you're not medically cleared. All of a sudden, all that goes away. And you're left, you know, with just the papers and the memories. And I my heart was breaking for her when she talked, you know, was talking about that. I'm like, I can only imagine the number of people that came out of the woodwork wanting to hitch their wagon, you know, to her success. And then to find out that, you know, she's going to have surgery, and then it's gone. And then all those people disappear. You know, absolutely incredible. Just a fabulous, fabulous person, very down to earth, and had a great time talking to her. I can't stress it enough. I hope everybody enjoyed it. I know that I did.
I think you did a great job on the interview, Bob.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
And speaking of that, I just want to say that Bob Delph is officially over.
I am.
Everybody needs to go to Matt Hardy's Instagram page, where he's been putting pictures of all his fans and interactions and achievements throughout the years. And you will find on Matt Hardy's latest post that photo number 2 is none other than our own Bob Delph. Matt has him in a headlock.
Yeah.
And thank you, Matt, for cropping the photo so that Live from the Armory on Bob's T-shirt is prominent.
Oh, is it
prominent?
It is.
It is.
Oh, awesome.
No.
It's a double
thank
kudos
you very much.
Moment, then.
Matt Hardy, yes. But, that's
thank
awesome,
you.
Bob.
I'm
very jealous. I'm waiting, still hoping and waiting that that perhaps
you,
John and I, when we took our pictures with him at WrestleCade when he was doing the broken gimmick.
I hope so. Those are good pictures.
We'll show up. But, you know, there's something that I want to talk about that John told me that someone on the internet wrote, and unfortunately I don't know where it came from.
Okay.
But it was after, and this is really funny, it was after Ring of Honor sold out Madison Square Garden. People were asking, well, where, you know, who is, not necessarily the blame, but who do we owe this to, this great accolade? Who's most responsible for it? And do you know who is most responsible for it, Bob?
Who is most responsible for the Madison Square Garden sellout?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Who's,
Vince McMahon.
You know?
I don't know. Who?
Nope.
Who's most responsible?
Dixie Carter.
Okay. You can call me. You can call me dumb. I get the 6 degrees of separation with Kevin Bacon. But tell me, dear lady,
let me tell you, Bob,
how Dixie Carter is responsible for the Madison Square Garden sellout.
Picture this.
I'm
going to throw a little Sophia from the Golden Girls on you.
I'm closing my eyes. All right.
TNA, 2009.
Yeah.
Jeff Jarrett and Jim Cornette are not getting along. TNA at all.
Can't stand each other. Yeah.
So Jeff Jarrett convinces Dixie Carter to fire Jim Cornette.
Get him out.
And she does. She does fire Jim Cornette. Fires him.
Gone.
He's gone. So the owner of Ring of Honor was getting ready to fold the company in 2009. I did not know that. They were going to have one last hoorah at the Hammerstein Ballroom.
Okay.
And he was going to shut up the company. Jim Cornette gets in touch with him and says, look, here, let me see if I can't get you a sponsor, a buyer, something. Let's not close this company. Not yet. So Jim Cornette, and I don't know the names, and I do apologize, folks. He gets in touch with an old friend of his from WCW, a promoter out of Baltimore, who has connections in the business and in the entertainment industry, and gets the owner of Ring of Honor, which George Coles is going to shoot me for not remembering his name, in
Gabe
touch Sapolsky. With the guys from, it's not Gabe. It's
not
someone
Gabe.
Else. I remember Gabe.
Okay. It's the other guy. Jeff
yeah.
Koff. Okay.
Yeah, I think
Joe
that's
Koff.
The name. Yeah.
Right, okay.
So he gets him in touch with Sinclair Broadcasting. So Sinclair, the people who own Sinclair are wrestling fans. So they buy Ring of Honor. Ring of Honor doesn't fold up. Keeps on going strong. And 9 years later, here we are, Ring of Honor has sold out the holy grail of wrestling arena, Madison Square Garden. So I'd like to say thank you to Dixie Carter firing Jim Cornette 9 years ago. I'll be over in the corner. Take all that in. Isn't that something? I mean, she finally had success, just not with the company that she owns. She finally created some success. Just not with TNA.
Well, now it's going to be 6 degrees of separation with Dixie Carter instead of Kevin Bacon.
Yes, it is.
It's
and
a strange domino effect with it. What do they call that? The butterfly effect? You know,
yeah.
The positive,
mm-hmm.
the negative, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Strange.
So, yeah. I mean, we owe, Corny. Corny's got a part to play in that, too. Jeff Jarrett,
all of them.
But it all... You know, if Dixie Carter hadn't fired Jim Cornette, more than likely, Ring of Honor would not even be in existence.
Oh, my God.
I just wanted to throw that at you.
I appreciate that, and I'm sure the parody account that follows me, Dixie's Wonky Eye, will probably pick up on that, too. So
I know who does Dixie's Wonky Eye.
Okay, all right. Good to know. A couple of things that I wanted to... Couple of things I wanted to run down that I wanted to make sure that we got out. Atlanta Wrestling Entertainment announced that they're going to be running shows not only in Atlanta but in Billerica, Georgia. And I watched the live feed, and I'm going to, I believe her name is Micah, that she is the social media director for Atlanta Wrestling Entertainment. Now, announced a 16-man block tournament, something similar, I would imagine, to like the G1. That will be taking place over season 5 for Atlanta Wrestling Entertainment. 16 different competitors will be announced probably coming up within the next couple of months for season 5 of Atlanta Wrestling Entertainment. Very interesting concept to run this at a local level. I really like it. Also, I hate to give this out because I don't know if I should or not. I'm going to go on and do it because she's been a guest on this show and it's been all over the internet. I wouldn't feel so bad about it. Here's what I get. Here's what I don't get. We all don't like spoilers, but yet when the promotion promotes it as a major headline, it doesn't feel like a spoiler. Why would
really called a spoiler, right?
I guess not. I mean, I guess maybe to drive ratings up, but I mean, she's already already putting ratings up. So I don't get it. To boil it all down, folks, we would like to congratulate former show guest Tessa Blanchard on winning the Knockouts Championship at Impact Wrestling. I want to send out a congratulations to Tessa.
Proud of her. So proud of her. And George South is beaming. I can see it all the way from, up here. You know, he's just incredibly proud of Tessa and of Ariel and of Cedric. And if you haven't seen the little interaction that Chris was talking about with Cedric and AJ and Ariel, because AJ was like, "That's my mom! That's my mom!" And to have seen AJ as just a little bitty baby when Ariel and Cedric would bring her to PWX, and now, you know, she's grown so big, and it's just really good to see her so proud of her mama, you know. And good on Ariel, because she has come a long way from when she first started. You know, the Storm gimmick at Fantasy, the cosplay wrestling.
Fantasy cosplay, yeah.
yeah, that was just, that's a great gimmick for her, Storm. Great gimmick. But, yeah, I love to see what Ariel is going to do. And she does have one thing over Cedric. She beat him to appearing on Raw.
That is true.
She wrestled Nia Jax on Raw before Cedric even appeared on Raw. So
that's true.
Yeah, just, you know, it's just great.
One up and left
that,
and right.
You know.
Yeah. I had mentioned last week, and I told everybody I'd get the information, there was another show, another promotion that had gotten signed to a television deal, and I alluded to it last week, Ring Warriors. Ring Warriors out of Las Vegas, Nevada, will be on WGN America. Their new debut show will happen on September 15th, and I know that I mentioned some of the names last week, Austin Aries, former show guest Luke Hawks. I saw there were several people that were on there. This will be another wrestling promotion recently signed to television. The tapings were held at the Samstown Casino and Resort in Las Vegas, but you'll be able to catch them on Saturday mornings on WGN America starting September 15th, and that's the Ring Warriors promotion.
What time?
8 a.m. is what it has listed, and okay. I imagine that would be subject to change. Maybe they might move it to a different slot, but starting September 15th on WGN America, Ring Warriors. The last thing that I saw, and I really don't have a whole lot to say about it because, to be honest with you, it is what it is, and anybody that ever tells you that it's never about the money, it's always, always about the money. Colt Cabana.
Somebody's money.
Yeah. Well, CM Punk's money. Colt Cabana is suing CM Punk. This has obviously been all over the internet this past week. They have been close friends since their days in the Chicago independent wrestling scene. Cabana's lawsuit contends that Punk promised to help him out with legal bills in their recent lawsuit against the physician for the WWE. Cabana claims Punk told him in a text that he would be 100% covered. Punk has failed to keep that promise, leaving him paid legal bills totaling $513,736, according to the lawsuit. Punk asked Cabana to pay half of the legal fees, which comes to $256,868. Long story short, and I put this out on social media, I don't know how it is that a guy that can't pay his attorney bills is able to hire an attorney to sue somebody. I guess he's working pro bono at all, or however you want to call it.
I don't get that either. I don't. But I will say this about this whole mess is that there's more to this than what we know. There has to be. Because
here's the deal. They had an idea of what was going to happen when they dropped the podcast, you know, and Punk went on his 2.5-hour rant about everything that happened to him, from, you know, Triple H to the doctor to the grind and all this and all that. I read the transcripts. We talked about the transcripts from the court proceedings during the lawsuit on this program. The doctor basically gave them the decision. I mean, he said, you know, in a court of law that he suffered, you know, no ill repercussions from it. It didn't affect his business. It didn't affect his personal life. He had some indigestion over Thanksgiving dinner. Exactly. I mean, the doctor pretty much handed them the case on a silver platter. I mean, I think this thing was wrapped up in like 5 days, 6 days. What the hell was this all really about? This doesn't make any sense at all. So now you're stuck with all these legal bills and, you know, all that.
To damage Punk that way.
It's all about money. I mean,
the thing that really was most telling is in one of the texts, he said, you know, Punk was basically, you can pay this or you can, you know, not. And, you know, come at me, and this is paraphrased. This is not the exact way it went.
Come at me, bro.
Or you can do the, Yeah, come at me, bro. You can do the right thing, but I've given up on you doing the right thing a long time ago.
Yeah, there's a lot. There's bad blood back. Yeah, there's bad blood there, and you know, it just, I don't know. This is why we can't have nice things. This is why we have to separate individuals during play time, and we have to lay everybody down for a nap.
I still love CM Punk.
Yeah.
I still love CM Punk. He's one of my favorite wrestlers. I would love to meet him one day, not necessarily in a wrestling setting.
Yeah.
I'm not particularly fond of Colt Cabana because I know some things he's done to a friend of mine, and not all that fond of him. With that being said, they could work out their differences in some way. Obviously, I don't think they'll ever be friends again.
I think they're going to work out their differences in a court of law is what's going to end up.
Well, that's what I was trying to say, is I wish they could work out their differences without having to resort to that. But, you know, it's just a shame. It is a shame.
I get it. You want to go on and read off the indie events that we have spotlighted for this week?
Yeah, as soon as I boot up the old tablet here and find out what it is you have sent.
Well, I thought you had the tablet up.
I did, but it was on the Twitter machine.
Oh.
So, yeah.
I see.
Oh, here we go. Innovate Wrestling presents Fire on the Mountain, Run Boys Run, Saturday, August 18th at the Kingsport Civic Auditorium in Kingsport, Tennessee. You can find out more information by visiting www.innovatewrestling.com. That's a great little building there for wrestling, not a bad seat in the place. I've been there. PWX presents the Land of Opportunity Sunday, August 19th at the Cabarrus Arena in Concord, North Carolina. You can find out more information by visiting www.pwxpro.com. NAWA presents the Shane Buddy Memorial Tournament.
The Buddy Shane Memorial Tournament.
What did I say?
The Shane Buddy.
Shane Buddy, Buddy Shane. You know, you can't tell West Virginia from Virginia, so hush. Saturday, August 18th at the American Legion Hall in Lenoir, North Carolina. You can find out more information by visiting NAWA Professional Wrestling. Say this real quick. I'm on my Fitbit. I'm on several challenges. I have people at work where we try to beat one another with the work week hustle. I'm on with John as well, and he beats the crap out of me because I sit and he's up all day. Big Donnie has beaten the crap out of me too. I mean, just literally just beating the crap right out of me. He'll be at the NAWA, the Buddy Shane Memorial Tournament. I just want to throw that out there, that Big Donnie beats the crap out of me.
I'm going to call him out. I think Big Donnie's been taking that Fitbit and tying it onto the ceiling fan. That's what I think he's been doing. I'm calling you out, Big Donnie. Calling you out, dog. We'll see. We'll see him in November. I'll find out for sure.
That's right. You will.
Go on and announce next week's guest. Next week on this very program, we will welcome Mr. Keith Mack. Highly energetic, highly entertaining. We're going to have the Mack, not that Mack, but the Mack. Keith Mack will be joining us next week. Very excited to have Keith on the show. He's a fun guy, so should have a good time with him. Is there anything else you'd like to add before we call it an evening?
Two things. I'd just like to say, hey, to Tracy Myers, I saw you on Raw. You and Presley down on the front row.
Down front.
Johnny, like to say hello to Johnny Smalls. He was down on the front row as well.
Yeah.
I'd like to say I'm so glad that Caleb Conley smacked a luchador. I can't remember if it was Phoenix or Pentagon Jr., that he smacked the taste out of his mouth, which is what he's supposed to do on Impact Wrestling. So I just wanted to get my BFF a little plug in there, a little shout out, if you will.
Well, you know, the cool thing is that, you know, he may be your BFF, but he very well could be like, I don't know, we could, his nickname like B.O.B., because Pentagon is the breaker of bones. Caleb may be walking around in the sling if he keeps trying to slap people that he shouldn't be slapping. Folks, we thank you very much for listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show. Tonight we're heard live every Wednesday night, 7 o'clock Eastern Time on Blog Talk Radio. We're available on FNX.network, on iTunes, on Stitcher, on YouTube. We thank you very much for listening tonight. We'll be back here next Wednesday night. And remember, there's never a bad seat here at the Armory. Thank you for listening. Enjoy your week.
You have been listening to Live from the Armory Wrestling Show, the premier podcast of indie wrestling. Listen to us on blogtalkradio.com every Wednesday night at 7 p.m. Eastern Time. Subscribe to us on iTunes. Follow us on Twitter at From the Armory. We're also streamed worldwide on www.fnx.network. And we're also available on Stitcher. You can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/live.armory.9. If you like what you hear, please take a few moments to give us a 5-star rating on iTunes. Thank you for listening. See you next week.
The Starlight Lounge presents An Evening with the Progressive Box.
Oh, what a great audience. Let's dim the lights for this next one. Nope, too much. Ah, there it is. Gotta get things just right. Like Progressive's Name Your Price tool. Tell us what you want to pay and we help you find coverage options that fit your budget. And now, the mood is right. Wait, the lights are back on again. Trudy, can you? And now it's completely dark.
Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.